Welcome to Fresh Fire. Welcome to Regeneration Nashville. We're so honored to have you. And to our online community, thank you so much for joining us today. Will you, are you ready to ascend to that place of worship? Amen? Amen. Will you pray with me? So, Father, we're so privileged to be in your house today. We praise you. We give you glory and we give you honor, God. You have called us for kingdom business in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, for you have raised us up and you have seated us together in heavenly places. And it is from that position that we commit this service to you in Jesus' name. And we say, kingdom of God, come. Will of God be done in this sanctuary, in and among these people, in the city of Nashville, across the nation and around the world. Kingdom of God, come. Will of God be done in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Come on and put your hands together for Jesus.
Save me.
love him today, church? Will you lift your hands? Just say, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Oh, when we look back, he's been so faithful. Has he been good to you? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. such a sweet spirit. There's a sweet spirit here. Come on, one more time. You are Alpha and Omega. Yes. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Just press in for a moment. Come on, in your own words, worship him. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. We press in today, Lord. We rest in your presence. We rest in your anointing. Oh, we trust you, Lord. Bless the name, bless the name. Bless the name of Jesus. We bless the name of Jesus.
so good to us this weekend. He's been so faithful. Man, I already feel his presence here. I don't think he's left all weekend. Amen. You can be seated as we prepare our hearts to give. And I was thinking of this verse this morning. I'll read it to you. It's Deuteronomy chapter 28, and it's a promise for those who obey the Lord, who follow his commandments. And it says, all these blessings will come and overtake you because you obey the Lord your God. You will be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. Your descendants will be blessed, and your land's produce and the offspring of your livestock, including the young of your herds and the newborn of your flocks. Your basket and your kneading bowl will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. And it's a good word. But I said, Lord, you know, I don't have any livestock, and I don't know how to use a kneading bowl, but the Lord will tailor the blessing to you. I know it sounds silly. I have a cat named Maverick, and he is a blessing to me. I asked the Lord to give me that specific one, and he did, and he's a blessing to me. But to my parents, it would have loosed a devourer in their house. They have a bird named Winston, and he would have went to meet Jesus just about the first day. It would not have been good. But to me, he was a blessing. And God knows how to tailor a blessing to you. And even I feel like that there are things that husbands, you haven't told your wives that have been in your heart, and wives, you haven't told your husbands, just secret things, even dreams that have they've been dormant in your heart, but God sees those things. And so I just want you to focus too, as you leave the conference, just say, Lord, bring those things again to the surface, because God is saying, you have not because you asked not. God's ready to meet you with the blessing, but he's ready for you to speak it with your mouth. And so let God bless you. Let the Lord tailor a blessing to you. And we'll go ahead and pray over the offering and give it with expectation and with joy, knowing that even as you're giving, the answer is on the way. The blessing is meeting you at the door. Amen. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you are in this place, Father. Lord, I thank you, God, that you see the sacrifice that people have made to be here, God. And Lord, you see the sacrifice even in the offering bucket as it goes by. But Lord Jesus, I thank you that you are just putting a blanket of blessing over this place. God, that even as people get back in their vehicles and they're driving home, Lord God, that when they get there, God, the blessing meets them at the door. God, it is chasing them and it is overtaking them. God, answered prayers. Lord, I thank you. You are bringing to the surface, God, desires, Lord, that it is in your heart to meet, God, and you are bringing them forth once again, and they will give voice to them. And Lord, you'll say, finally, finally, God, and meet them with the blessing. Lord, we honor you and thank you, God. We open our arms to receive what you will pour out here today. In Jesus' name, ushers, you may serve the people.
Good morning, Fresh Fire. Anybody on fire? Praise the Lord. I'm so happy that you're here today. Come on over here. This is my good-looking son-in-law right here. And yeah, that'd be great. I just wanted to tell you one more time that we have Pastor Kent's book out in the lobby, and a free gift to you is his book of prophecies transcribed from 2023. And I don't know, I forgot it somewhere, but anyway, he said, where's that at? I don't, the table. So hold it back up there. So if these don't sell like hotcakes, we're gonna have to eat them like hotcakes. No, I'm joking. So I just want to say, too, this is a story of tragedy to triumph. And this will be a great blessing to you. And so I just want to encourage you to get Pastor Kent's book, because I know that, first of all, you get to know he's a man of few words. And so for him to write that many words is a miracle, right in itself, okay? So anyway, and there's lots of, I just love a book with a lot of pictures. And so you know what? I made him put double pictures in there. So anyway, all right. Well, anyway, you're going to like this book. And this is Jasmine's new CD that we just got pre-release copies for this conference. It hasn't even been released yet, so you get the first copies. But I want to show you this right here, too. I pulled this out of my Bible because I use it. This is Holy Holy. How many of you are watching Jasmine's Holy Holy podcast? So if you're not, you're missing it because, sorry? She makes you read it. Yeah, she's got you toeing the mark, brother. So what it is, about 13 years ago, the Lord impressed on Jasmine to read the Bible through. She was nursing a baby. They were living in a little one-room apartment. And she's like, God, I can't read the Bible through. I got a lot going on. And the Lord said, read. And so that was 13 years ago, and she's been reading the Bible through. She's going to get her Master's of Divinity right now. And she pulls out so many nuggets. So what she's doing is she's helping the people of God read through the Bible in a year. Now you say, well, I didn't start in January. That's okay. That's all right. She's got a Bible reading plan for you, and it's important for the people of God. David said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of the sinner, but delights in the law of the Lord. And in his law, I'm just going to preach right here. I'm going to preach right here. In his law does he meditate day and night. He will be like a tree planted by rivers of water that bringeth forth. Oh my God, I'm just going to preach it right now. Anybody awake? Yeah. And everything he does shall prosper. So anyway, I want to encourage you to follow this Holy Holy read through the Bible. And thank you so much. Now y'all saw my good looking son-in-law. Where's my daughter-in-law? Y'all have met my son Nicholas that did the offering. My daughter that let, where's my daughter-in-law, Carrie? Come here, Carrie. I want y'all to see how good we did here. What's funny is they see little short Jasmine and they see Carrie here and they know Carrie's my daughter and Jasmine's my daughter-in-law. It's the other way. This is my daughter-in-law and I couldn't have a better one. We love our Carrie. Yeah, is she beautiful? You want to say something? She's just like her father-in-law, a woman of few words, but we honor you. We love you. God bless you. Thank you. I love what Brother Jensen Franklin said. He said, we don't have a sad story to tell. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere, he loved me ere I knew him and all my love. We're gonna go up. Come on, you got victory in the house this morning. We're going to sing, oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming. Oh, he loved me. He loved me ere. We're going up. We're going up. Yeah. And all my love. Plunged me to victory beneath the... Come on, let's go up one more time. Come on. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Time. Can we go up again? Lift me to victory. I double dog dare you just to sing it and hug people as you're singing it. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Well, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Oh, he loved me. Yeah. Jesus Christ, the greatest hand clap of the morning. Come on, give it up. We got victory. We got victory. Yeah, we got victory. No sad song. No sad song. We got victory in Jesus. Woo! Yeah! Yeah! We got victory. Hallelujah! We got victory. Hallelujah. All right, just stay standing. Because if I let you sit down, you're just going to get right back up. Because I got something to tell you. Do y'all remember that little boy we prayed for last night? So what did we pray? All right. So they said, well, we're going to do another ultrasound. Did another ultrasound. Said, yeah. Yeah, it's bad. It's bad. So we're all praying. This little boy, he's in the hospital, and he's watching me and you pray on the phone. He's told the doctor, he's told all the nurses. He said, my pastor and my church, they're praying for me. They're praying for me. So they get in there. Watch this, you're gonna love this. They put him on the gurney. They prepped him for surgery. They took him in, said it'd take about an hour and a half. I can't tell you how dire this was. This would have been life-altering for the rest of his life. And so I won't divulge what it is. It's a private matter. He had an accident. They took him into surgery, and the doctor came out to the mother. And the mother said, oh, my, what is it? She said, we can't find anything. We've sewn him up. We're sending him home. Sending him home. Yeah. Sit down. I tell you what, stand up. Why don't you give a big old warm, fresh fire welcome to Pastor Judy Jacobs? Yeah!
Lord, we're just so grateful and thankful for who you are and what you are. Thank you for this miracle that you have wrought. To you be all the glory and all the honor. Lord, we're here today because we're hungry and we want more of you. More of your goodness. More of your kindness. Everything that you have, we want it all. So today, Lord, we say, draw us into you. Draw us into you, Lord. We love you. We bless you in Jesus' name. You may be seated.
I'm running after thee. You're watching over me. With your arms open wide, there's a place where I hide. You are my heart's desire. There's an everlasting joy. Somebody's going to get their joy back today. Never-ending peace. Lift your hands and thank you for peace today. You're all we want. Father God, you're all we need. You're our heart's desire. You are greater than the grave. Wiser than the wise. In you, I find my strength.
I'd find healing. Lord, you're strong when I'm weak. You, I confide. You're a great place to hide. You are my heart's desire. Lift your hand and tell him that right now. Tell him, Lord, I want more. I want more of you, Lord. Come on, all over this room. Thank you, Lord, for keeping you again for another week. That, but I find healing, healing. I tell you, there's healing in this house. Your love is deeper than the deep. Oh, you're so strong. We're so weak. Through you I confide. A great place where I hide you. Nothing else but you, nobody else but you. I can't find anybody else but you. You're my everything, you're the bride and the morning star. You're Jesus, Jesus. Somebody shout Jesus, Jesus. You're my heart's desire. All over the room, lift your hand and tell him that. God, I want you, you're my desire this morning. I bless your name because you're worthy, Father. Because you deserve the glory and the honor. We lift our hands in worship, everybody, as we bless your holy name. You deserve the That's it. And the honor. As we bless your holy name, for you are great. Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
Miracles so great.
Oh, holy Jesus.
There is no one else like you.
Come on, tell him that today, church. There is no one else like you. Throw your hands up and tell him you are great. Hallelujah.
Miracles so great.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. I looked all over, I couldn't find anybody.
Turn to 10 people and tell them, I feel Holy Ghost in here. Go ahead, tell 10 people, I feel Holy Ghost in here. If you believe that, throw your hands up and shout, glory!
Peace.
it.
I feel yoke-destroying anointing in this room. Did you hear me? I said, I feel a yoke-destroying anointing in this room. Turn to somebody and say, it's coming off of you. Tell somebody, it's coming off of you. Hey! Say it! Say it loud! Say it louder! One more time. I believe one more time is going to break something in this room. Some of you need to jump. Some of you need to run. Some of you need to throw your hands up and begin to wave it and declare, this is my year of Jubilee. Come on, say it. Yeah. Oh, no God. Nobody. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Hey! He's the El Shaddai, the mighty God, the coming King.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. You can just sense the building of what God is doing in our spirit realm in the nation. You can find your seats. I promise you it's going to get better and better and better and more powerful. The glory of God spills out all over the world. Thank you, Sister Judy Jacobs. As always, fresh. Amen. Amen. Just a quick reminder that after the service, if you want to tour our new building, the Massey's on the front row with the hat 709 are going to conduct that tour, and it'll be a blessing to you. And when you pray, just thank God for the $20 million the Lord's going to give us to pay off that building. And just been so inspired over the last few days of the word of the Lord that's gone forth. I promise you, you will never be in a better conference than what you've been in this week. And just amazing speakers. Today is going to be wonderful. And I was looking at the crowd today and reflecting back on several years ago. We used to have conferences, and you know, if we had 80 people show up, it was that was about it. And I was looking at the crowd today and thanking God for just the blessing of the Lord that's been on the ministry. And even in my book, we write a lot about some of the difficult times and the dark places that we went through. And I've realized this about God, because memories never go away of bad times. But here's what happens. God takes the pain out of them. He leaves the memory, but he takes the pain out of them so you can have room to feel the pain of other people. That's how you heal people, is the memories let you remember where you were, but you don't hurt anymore. So you can take the pain of somebody else and bring them into a realm of victory. And I believe that God has healed the memories of his church, that we're going to be able to feel the pain of other people and to see them healed by the power of God. And so I want to say thank you for taking time in your busy schedule to come to this conference. Tomorrow will be our last service for this one, but by no means the end of the move of the Holy Ghost. And so today is with great joy to bring to our platform again a wonderful man of God. Dr. Hans Hess and his wife Dana are with us today. He's actually, of all the speakers I've had, he's the only one that I have a real long-term relationship with. And we go back years, from days of very small beginnings, and yet we see what God has done. And Pastor Hans is out of Elizabeth City, North Carolina. Pastors a tremendous church. Is a true doctor of theology, and I call him my friend. He's part of the covering of our ministry. And so it's with great honor today that I ask Dr. Hans Hess to come to share the word of the Lord, and let's welcome him as he comes.
Yes, sir. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise this morning. Can you just lift your hands and just close your eyes and tell him how much you love him, how much you appreciate him? Take about 60 seconds, 90 seconds, and tell the Lord just what he means to you this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we love you. Come on, just say it with your lips. Lord, we love you and we bless you this morning. We magnify you, Lord. God, I thank you for being present with us, a present help. God, thank you that you're with us this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. We give you praise. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, can somebody shout praise the Lord? We do something in our church that I think is just super cool. Turn around and tell somebody you love them and there's nothing they can do about it. And you can be seated. It's true. Such an honor to be here, and we came in last night and were able to hear Jensen Franklin, and what a tremendous services you guys have had. Then I have to follow Judy Jacobs, and but I learned years ago that I'm a terrible T.D. Jakes, I'm a terrible Joel Osteen, but I'm the best Hans Hess from Grundy, Virginia there's ever been. Hallelujah. It's an honor to be here. Pastor Ken, I honor you, and Pastor Candy, you guys have true friends through the years, and from the days in the resting place to here is just absolutely awesome. Amen. And some familiar faces who have been through the years with this process, I just honor you guys, the leaders, the elders of this church who've been here for a long time. You've held true and supported the man of God, and I really appreciate that. Many places I go in the United States and preach, and whether it's academic settings or church settings, people will often ask me about Kent Christmas and my association with him. And I always say, he's the real deal. He is the real deal. Real deal. I've been in their home, they've been in my home, and we walk together through suffering, and he's the real deal. Amen. Thanks to Nancy Alcorn. This is Dana's best friend in all the world. And we love Nancy, my friend Randy Hill, one of my best friends on planet Earth, and we've walked a similar road. So I just give honor to all the men and women of God. Some of our folks are here from Elizabeth City, God's country. Hallelujah. Coastal North Carolina, where I'm sure it's beautiful today. Brad and Shiloh. Brad's my executive pastor. Shiloh works on staff with us. And some of our ministers, Mark and Alexis Bailey, ministers in a conference that I'm bishop over. And just good friends. Amen? Amen. God is good. Well, this is Dana's home church. And a couple years ago, after a conference meeting, I flew in here from Colorado. And there was a reason I came, because Kent had called me and Kent said, we got somebody we think you should meet. And I'm like, oh, holy smoke, what in the world? So I came and I met Dana. And wow. And we haven't been back here since we got married. So I'm feeling it this morning. I feel a lot of emotion here. So I'm eternally grateful to Candy and Kent Christmas for introducing us. But this is Dana's home church, so I want her to come and say something. Come on. So let's give Dana a hand as she comes.
Ooh, good morning. I am so humbled to get to be a part of you guys and to be here with you. What a privilege it is. And I had no idea that God would have them introduce me to this incredible man. I never saw it coming. And I am so grateful. And it's very humbling to be a part of the journey with Hans. And I have been at a loss for words, only in front of people. But you changed my life when you introduced me to him. And I used to sit right there on the second row. And now we're in Elizabeth City, and it has been the greatest gift. So what a privilege it is to be here with you guys today. Amen.
Wow. So let's try to get through this now. My daughter texted me earlier. Both my daughters, I have two amazing daughters, and my grandsons are praying for me this morning. One's 3.5 years old, and the other's just 1.5. So, but the 1.5-year-old had the television on. He's getting ready to watch Papaw. So, hallelujah. God is good. Amen. If you have your Bibles, open with me this morning. I'm just going to go workmanlike through something that's been on my heart now for quite some time. And I just pray it's a blessing to you. I pray it really sets you free in your thinking, in your heart. And I just pray it's great. Amen. Open your Bibles to the book of Nahum, chapter 1. The book of Nahum, a minor prophet, Old Testament. We distinguish minor prophets from major prophets, not because of matters of importance, but minor prophets just wrote less. Major prophets wrote more. And if we set up the book of Nahum, we're in the 7th century BC, and he's prophesying to the capital city of the Assyrian Empire, a city called Nineveh. It was a great superpower. It was the superpower of its day, and it was a wicked city. A prophet 100 years before had gone there named Jonah. He didn't want to go there, but the Lord had him go there via a big fish. And he was vomited up on the shores, and he preached the gospel there, or preached the word of the Lord to them. And they repented and turned back, or turned to the living God. But this time a prophet is coming, and there's no call for repentance. It's just straight judgment. It's just straight judgment. God is getting ready to judge the city. He's getting ready to take it out. So what a great way to start the morning. Amen? Read with me Nahum chapter 1, verse 1. The burden against Nineveh, the book of the vision of Nahum the Elkoshite. God is jealous and the Lord avenges. The Lord avenges and is furious. The Lord will take vengeance on his adversaries, and he reserves wrath for his enemies. And the Lord is slow to anger and great in power, and will not at all acquit the wicked. The Lord has his way in the whirlwind and in the storm, and the clouds are the dust of his feet. He rebukes the sea and makes it dry, and dries up all the rivers. Bashan and Carmel wither, and the flower of Lebanon wilts. The mountains quake before him. The hills melt and the earth heaves at his presence. Yes, the world and all who dwell in it. Who can stand before his indignation? And who can endure the fierceness of his anger? His fury is poured out like fire, and the rocks are thrown down by him. Whew. Pause. Then he says, the Lord is good. The Lord is good. A stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knows those who trust in him. Maybe linguistically it should be written, the Lord is good because in the day of trouble, he's a stronghold for those who trust in him. Can we shout amen?
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, my God is better than you think. Come on, look at another neighbor and say, my God is better than you think. Think about this passage. Think about it. Nahum prophesying absolute destruction on an evil city, prophesying judgment of God on the wickedness that this city had spewed out for years and years. And then he pauses in the middle of it and reflects on the goodness of God toward those who love him or those who trust him. There's an obvious contrast in the text, a contrast between God's treatment of the wicked and God's treatment of the righteous. Last year, I did an experiment. I began reading through the Bible, and I chose a version that was just super cool to read through. So I started reading through. I like reading through different versions. So I just started reading through a different version. But this year, I said, I'm going to do something. I'm going to look at every page of the Bible, and I'm going to look for the goodness of God. I'm going to look for the goodness of God on every page. And I'm telling you what, it transformed my thinking. Because I put on a set of lenses, a hermeneutical set of lenses, that I'm going to interpret the scripture through the lenses of God's goodness. And it absolutely revolutionized the way I looked at scripture. And it started bothering me when when I would hear people caricaturize God in a certain way that didn't display his goodness. And I thought about it. You know, when Moses didn't speak to the rock, he struck the rock the second time with this event with the rock. Scholars say part of the reason why God judged him and he couldn't go into the promised land was because he misrepresented God before the people. And I thought, Lord, I don't want to be guilty of misrepresenting you before your people or before the world. And so I want to plunge for a few minutes into this subject of God's goodness and find out he's really better than you think he is. He's really better than you think he is. But to properly focus this in, you know, to have great pictures, you need great lighting and great backdrop, right? So to properly focus this subject in, I want to paint a backdrop for the goodness of God, which is, I want to bring out the reality of an enemy that we fight, an enemy in Scripture. You see, the goodness of God is evident all the more when displayed against the backdrop of evil. Or the goodness of God is, it comes across like a soothing symphony when it's placed against a backdrop of this, like, cacophony of discordant voices. The goodness of God is like a drink from a clear mountain stream on a sweltering August day as the backdrop. You see, we fight a real enemy, and there's real evil in the world. And I don't know about you, I don't need God fighting against me. I need a God that's good all the time. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I have 2 points this morning. I'm a points preacher, but you're going to remember these points if you never remember any sermon in your life. Number one, point one, devil is bad. Look at your neighbor and say, devil is bad. I'm going to go ahead and give you the second point. Point number two, God is good. Look at another neighbor and say, point two, God is good. When God created the heavens and the earth, the Bible says he made everything good. Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. It was very good. Then we fast forward over 2 chapters after that, and we find in Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve being encountered by a serpent, that's Satan in a physical form. And this serpent not only moves and slithers or walks on all fours, but he also talks. Of all creatures God has created, I hate snakes more than anything. And if I grew up in the Appalachian Mountains, so we encountered snakes and poisonous snakes, and it would just send chills all over my body. I couldn't imagine how I would have reacted if I encountered one that could walk and talk. They encounter this snake, and the snake deceives Adam and Eve and throws them into the fall of man, as you've read about in your Bibles. But yet, what happened between Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, and Genesis chapter 3? What happened in those chapters? Something significant shifted. So we can theorize here for a moment this morning. Number one, we think maybe Adam and Eve were planted on planet Earth and Satan was already here. He had already fallen and had already come to the earth realm, and they were planted basically in the midst of a warfare. Another option is that he fell between Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 3. Something happened and he came, and there was this cataclysmic fall, and he came to earth, and then Adam and Eve end up in the midst of a battle. Whatever the case, we believe Isaiah's word to a certain king in Isaiah 14 represent Satan and the beginning of his fall. Isaiah chapter 14, how you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the earth. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. You see, Satan's issue was pride. He wanted to ascend the heavens and be equal or above God. And the term Satan really develops in the Old Testament and emerges out of the book of Job and out of 2 Chronicles. And the instance in Job 1, the Bible says there was a day when the sons of God came to be present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. This term Satan in Old Testament Hebrew simply means the adversary. Jesus spoke directly to him in the wilderness temptations in Matthew chapter 4 when he said, "Away with you, Satan." He came face to face with him. Jesus said he was a murderer from the beginning. He was a liar and the father of lies. The New Testament uses a term called the devil, and it comes out of the Latin, and the devil really means a slanderer. So let's look at some of the things that the enemy brings to the earth realm. First of all, he is the originator of sin and tries to get other people drawn into sin along with him. 2 Corinthians 11, Paul said, "I fear lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds will be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." He lies and he murders. Jesus told the religious leaders in John 8, "You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do." He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in truth. He deceives the world. Revelation chapter 12, that great dragon was cast out, the serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. The Bible says he will try everything in his power to blind individuals from the truth of the gospel. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, in whom the God of this age has blinded who do not believe. He keeps people in bondage so they won't come to God. He uses tactics like temptation, fear, doubt, confusion, sickness, envy, pride, slander, on and on and on to keep you from the purposes God has for your life. And there's something that I guess I'd read about and it was in theory to me, but when I experienced it, it became in living color to me, and that is Satan hates you. He wants to take you out, and if he can, he will kill you. I guess I lived in some kind of ethereal dream world that I didn't believe that Satan actually killed people. And now I realize he kills people. He takes people out. We have a real enemy. And sometimes the way we talk about God, we place everything onto God's sovereignty and forget there is a real enemy and that we are living in a fallen world and people make stupid choices. I know y'all know this. This is elementary preaching, but I just want to refurbish the idea and take the blinders off of us again. We have a real enemy in this world. And to be transparent, you know, a few years ago, I went through the greatest tragedy of my life, and my wife kept telling me, "There's witchcraft against us. There's people praying against us, Hans." And I thought, well, she's a little radical. Let me see where I can find that in a theology book. But she kept saying, "There's people praying against us, and there's witchcraft against us." And then freaky things started happening. And I'm not here to scare you this morning, but I want to awaken you. There's a real enemy in this world that wants to take you out. He wants to take you out. And sometimes we chalk it up to the sovereignty of God, but I'm telling you what, the God I know doesn't use cancer to take you out. The God I know doesn't use tragedy in your life to snuff out the design he's placed in you and purpose he's placed in you. I had to learn this the hard way. I realized I'm in a perpetual season of jubilee in my life. I'm under the perpetual fountain of the favor of God, and God has not sent me here to be, you know, mincemeat for the devil. He sent me here to be a champion, hallelujah, in the kingdom. He sent me here to be a fire on the earth. He sent me here to work in miracles, signs, and wonders, preaching the word of deliverance to the nations. Somebody give him a shout, hallelujah. Let me dig a little deeper into this. So Satan has a whole horde of spirit beings working with him called demons. Where do demons come from? Well, there's many different theories, and I won't walk through all the theories, but the simplest shortcut is just they're fallen angels. They're fallen angels who came with him in a great deception and rebellion against God, and now they're on earth. They know their fate. They know they are doomed. They are evil to the core, and their job is to make your life miserable. Many of you have encountered them, or maybe you're walking around and you don't know they exist. If so, I pray this message opens that up to you, that revelation. Several years ago, I was preaching in West Africa, and I was in a service on a Sunday morning, and as I'm preaching, a lady falls to the ground and starts writhing like a snake. Now, I've seen this many times in services, so I went over to minister to the lady, but the thought occurred to me, why do we not see this in America? Why do we not see this in America? Somebody says they're in America just like everywhere else, they're just maybe better medicated. So I came back to my church, and on that next Sunday, I preached. And after I preached, we finished the service. I walked down the aisle and met a young man at the back of our sanctuary. I hadn't seen him in a while, and I'm like, hey, man, great to see you, bro. How you doing? And I hugged him, and all of a sudden, his voice shifted, his action shifted, and demons started speaking through this boy. And I thought, okay. It's in America just like it's in West Africa. Satan's kingdom is everywhere, and he reigns in a certain limited capacity because of the wickedness and sinfulness of human beings. The way to unseat him is to have Holy Ghost revival where people change and start living holy lives, and it brings down the principalities and their authority in the heavenlies. Can somebody shout amen? So Satan is bad. Come on, just shout it out. Satan, bad. Devil, bad. But I've got better news for you this morning. God is good, and he is better than you think he is. God is good, and he is better than you think he is. If you don't believe the devil exists, hopefully you do now, but I know you believe God exists. What else makes sense in this earth except the existence of God? Let me run through just a few facts that just convince me all the more that God is real, he is present, and that he is good. First of all, the existence of God is the only thing that makes sense out of the origin of life. It's the only thing that really makes sense. The existence of God is the only thing that really makes sense of the fine-tuning of the universe to sustain human life. The existence of God only makes sense out of objective moral values we have in this world. You see, there are transcendental values. There are real rights and real wrongs. And if Satan would have his way, he would blind us to the fact that there is a creator, because if there is no creator, then there is no transcendental law. If there is no transcendental law, there's no such thing as a transgression against that law. If there's no transgression against that law, there is no sin. If there is no sin, there's no need for a savior. There's no need for a church. There's no need for this thing that we're doing this morning called a worship service. So Satan would love to blind the minds of the world to believe that God doesn't exist, that he isn't a creator. But I'm telling you what, there is a God. He does exist. He created everything that we see. He created all the birds and all the sea creatures and the beautiful morning we have. He created you as the apex of his genius and the apex of his creation. He created you male and female. He created you to represent his glory on earth. He created you as a divine agent to take dominion over the earth, hallelujah, and to extend the blessing and kingdom of God to the four corners of this planet. Can somebody shout hallelujah? Shout it out. God is good, and he's better than you think. The existence of God is the only thing that makes sense out of life, out of death, out of future resurrection. God is known. He can be known, and he can be experienced. Life is meaningless without God. Without God, we have no hope. If God doesn't exist, we have no destiny. If God doesn't exist, we have no eternal purpose. If God doesn't exist, we're left with a terrible option. As the existentialist Jean-Paul Sartre said, all we're left with is the question of, how do I commit suicide? But with God, I am infused with meaning. I'm infused with wonder. I wake up every morning and lift my hands and say, thank you, Jesus, for another day. Thank you, Lord, for this day. And you are good, and you are good all the time. And you're going to show your goodness to me some way. Hallelujah. And I'm going to be able to spread your goodness some way this day. Can you lift your hands and say the same? God, I thank you that you are good. Dig a little deeper. Let me show you a few more things this morning before we pray. Acts chapter 10, verse 38 does it for me. It seals the deal for me. You see, what happened is Satan brought the earth down by deception into a fallen state. And then God started working his covenant plan. He started working with Abraham. He worked with the Israelites. He worked all through the prophetic voices. And he came to the ultimate manifestation of his covenant ideal in the person of Jesus. God himself coming to earth in human flesh. And what did Jesus do? Jesus came, according to the Apostle John, to destroy the works of the devil. He didn't come to team with him. He didn't come to make excuses. He didn't come to philosophize about the evil in the world. He came to destroy his works. That's why when Jesus comes out in ministry, he's healing the sick, casting out demons, raising the dead, feeding hungry people, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and then he sends his disciples out, and he didn't say necessarily, go write philosophical books on why there's evil and theodicy in the world. He said, you go, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons, preach the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Jesus came to absolutely exert kingdom dominion and authority in this world. And church, if you're in the kingdom, you're in that dominion realm of healing and blessing and miracles. Hallelujah. If you're a faith person, you're walking in the kingdom blessing of the new age right now. I had to come to this realization that if I'm going to pray for people, I can't go to pray for somebody and have this doubt in my mind. Is it the sovereign will of God to bless this person or not? Is it the sovereign will of God to put them through torture or not? Is God worth? Because my wife of 28 years died of cancer. And that was a theological dilemma for me. And I came to this crossroads to where I thought, either I'm not going to believe this stuff, or I'm going to dig in harder than I've ever done before and believe it with every fiber of my being. I chose the latter. And I chose to back out of the arguments as to why this happened and what was God. I just backed out of it all. And I said, God, you're good all the time. I don't understand everything, but I know you are good. And I know when you want me to lay hands on people, you want me to bring kingdom power and life to that person. Healing the sick, casting out demons, raising the dead, preaching the gospel. That's what he wants us to bring. And when I started doing this, we've seen amazing miracles happen in our church. After my wife passed, I came back to the church and I started preaching. And the second Sunday in, I said, I'm going to step out on faith and I'm going to call an altar call for anybody who has cancer. That morning, three ladies came down to the altar who had cancer. So I went to the first lady and I said, what's going on? She said, well, I've been diagnosed with breast cancer. And I said, okay, we're going to pray and believe God. I laid hands on her. I came to the next lady, and I said, what's going on with you? And she said, well, they think I have ovarian cancer. And that's the cancer we had just battled. And when she said it, I backed up. And I said, oh, Lord. Last time I tried this, it didn't work. And I honestly felt it was a test. Are you going to believe me in this? Or are you going to hang it all up? And I said, Lord, I'm going to believe you. And I stepped forward, and I laid hands on that lady. Okay, don't know what happened to her. 4 years went by, never heard. But I knew there was power of God. And I told this story in the church, our church in Elizabeth City, a couple months ago. And someone instant messaged me on Messenger. And they said, Pastor Hans, you're talking about my daughter-in-law. She actually, they thought she had ovarian cancer, but after you prayed for her, they found out it was just a benign cyst. Now, you can believe what you want to believe. I'm going to live on the believing side that thing melted that morning in the name of Jesus. Woo! Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. My God is good all the time. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good and healing all. Doing good and healing all who are oppressed by the devil. I don't think all is hyperbole. I think when it says all, it means every single person. He went about doing good and healing all who are oppressed of the devil. Doing the will of God is casting out demons. Doing the will of God is healing the sick. Doing the will of God is living in victory your whole life. Doing the will of God is believing in His goodness, letting His goodness encourage you, letting His goodness propel you into tomorrow, knowing that God has a future and God has a hope for you. He's not left you in the dust. Hallelujah. Maybe the world has come against you. Maybe people have come against you. Maybe the enemy has thrown everything he has against you. But I can tell you, in all these things, you are more than a conqueror through Him who loved you. You're a winner. Hallelujah. The battle's already been won in the heavenlies. You're a victor. You're a champion. You are a winner. Shout it out. I win. Look at your neighbor and say, you win. Oh, give the Lord a hand clap of praise in here this morning. I'm going to show you one more thing, and this is just hot off the press. My church is getting this tomorrow. Hallelujah. I want to show you one thing, and we're going to pray, because I'm believing God's going to heal people this morning. N.T. Wright, great New Testament Greek scholar, Anglican bishop, says the most misunderstood passage in the entire Bible is Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good. N.T. Wright says it's the most misunderstood passage in the New Testament, because God works all things is a Greek term, soon energe. And that term soon energe, energe is the energy, is a work. But soon, he believes, should be translated with, not for. How does that change? It changes everything. That God, because some people take this as a New Age cosmic idea, that all the forces of the universe will work together and everything's going to wash out perfectly. It's not at all what Paul is saying. He's saying God's going to come on the battleground with you. He's going to soon energe. He's going to work with you. And I don't know where we lost our contextual exegesis, but the passage before, literally the verse before says, we don't know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. That means, brother, when the enemy attacks, Holy Ghost starts praying through you. It means when the world attacks, Holy Ghost starts praying through you. And it doesn't mean God's saying, well, I'm going to see how much suffering they can go through. I'm going to see how far down that. No, he says, I'm going to step onto the battlefield with them, and I'm going to start working my stuff with them, and I'm going to work out my plan for them as they pray in the Holy Ghost, as they move in the dynamics of the Spirit, as they operate in great faith. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout glory to God. Then he says, you ask a rhetorical question in the following verses. If God is for us, who can be against us? In other words, if God is for us, yes, he is for us, then who can stand against us? If Jesus is my elder brother over my right shoulder, it doesn't matter what comes against you. It will not take you out if you don't let it take you out. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah. My God, I feel freedom in this house this morning. My God, somebody lift your hand and say, God, I thank you that you are better than I ever thought you were. Oh, somebody shout hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to pray here in a second. Let me just close out with this. This changes everything. Somebody said, well, God used storms in Paul's life. Yeah, because the people wouldn't listen to his advice. He told them, don't get on the boat. But what happened? In the midst of stupid people, God stepped in and came by Paul and appeared to him at night and said, you're going to be all right. Nobody's going to be lost in this. He stepped on the battlefield with him, working soon in erge, working with him in the fight. Somebody shout hallelujah. 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 I believe that we're going to see miracles, signs, and wonders in the upcoming days like we've never seen miracles, signs, and wonders in our life. Somebody says miracles aren't important. Baloney. Read the New Testament. I worked under a scholar who did content analysis of the New Testament, and the majority of New Testament gospel happenings and events deal with miracles, signs, and wonders. Look at the 385 mentions of the term spirit in the Bible. 85% of them deal with prophetic revelation or miracles. And so we write our theological books, and we give one page to miracles, and we give all of this ton, these tomes, to some kind of high-end pneumatology or Christology, and we don't get down to what the Bible actually dealt with, and that is, I'm sending my spirit so you can have direct communication with the Father, so you can have prophetic words coming forth, so you can have prophetic direction in your life. I'm sending my spirit so the enemy will not take you out, because I'm working with you, healing your sicknesses, healing your diseases, placing my favor on your life. I'm coming as with the whole load. I'm coming with the whole truckload of the blessings of God. 2 years ago, this is one of my coolest stories, and we're going to close. But 2 years ago, we had a tent meeting on our property with my good friend Ted Shuttlesworth. And one of the last nights of the meeting, there was a grandmother who came from Central Virginia and drove all the way to the coast of North Carolina with her grandson. Her grandson, first of all, they came to the altar, and this grandma was shouting and waving and screaming, and finally Brother Ted was like, what do you want? And they brought this boy with his grandma up on stage, and they're like here at the platform, and I'm about 10 feet behind looking at it. And this boy, his eyes were like trembling, and you could tell he couldn't see. The story went, 10 years prior to that, he had been in a car accident and had lost his sight. And Brother Ted prayed for him and just shouted, go! And when he did it, a demonic spirit left. And the boy went. Full sight restored. Full sight restored. We started playing music and shouting and dancing and people. The last scene I have of that night is in our yard on the grass, this grandma and her son jumping up and down. You see, miracles are demonstrations, as T.L. Osborne said, of God's love to you. Don't despise miracles. They're the demonstrations of God's love to you. God's love is toward you. His favor is toward you. He didn't get up this morning. First of all, he didn't wake up at all. He's in the eternal present. But he didn't get you up this morning and say, man, I'm going to see how I can make their life miserable. No, I don't think he teams with the enemy. He's standing up this morning saying, I'm going to bless this person if they just let me do it. I'm going to position them for blessings if they allow me to do it. And I'm going to unload my blessing on them so much that they don't even know how good I am yet. Because he's better than we think. Hallelujah. Let's all stand in here this morning. Come on, lift your hand with me and just say, Father, I thank you that you're better than I think. I thank you for $20 million. Thank you for it all, debt-free. Hallelujah. Because we're believing somebody's going to come to Elizabeth City. Some of that blessing will flow. Oh, we have plans we're working on right now to expand our sanctuary. We're debt-free right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Believing to continue that way. But come on, if you have a physical sickness in your body, I want you to lift your hand right now. If you have just something you're dealing with, a physical sickness in your body, I just want to let you know God's not against you. He's better than you think he is. He's better than you think he is. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to command this sickness to go from your body. And as we do that, I want the rest of the church to be interceding. Intercede in the Holy Ghost. Intercede in the Spirit. Amen. So let's do it right now. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we just command healing to come into your body right now. Sicknesses be healed, be gone in the name of Jesus. Sugar diabetes go in the name of Jesus. Neck issues go right now in the name of Jesus. Somebody with soreness in your left lower leg goes right now in the name of Jesus. Back issues go right now in the name of Jesus. Heart problems be healed right now in the name of Jesus. Come on, everybody pray and receive his power right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, for miracles right now breaking forth in this room. Come on, church, pray. Lift it up a little bit louder. Come on, we believe God for miracles breaking forth. Lord, we just pray financial debts be canceled right now and broken off lives in Jesus' name. God, release that full year of Jubilee in this house this morning in the name of Jesus, and we give you praise for doing it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Right now, come on, press through right now. Say, God, I believe, I receive right now in Jesus' name. We receive a turnaround. Hallelujah. We receive a turnaround. The church is your pastoring. We receive it. We declare a turnaround in that church right now in Jesus' name. We just declare a turnaround right now. Open heaven over your church in the name of Jesus. Miracles breaking forth in your church in the name of Jesus. Holy Ghost revival breaking forth in your church in the name of Jesus. Those watching us online, we just pray healing virtue go in the name of Jesus to you wherever you are. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, if you receive it, lift up your voice and give the Lord a shout in here this morning. Come on, lift up your voice and give him a shout. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah, hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I believe in receiving things by faith. I believe in receiving things by faith. So if we receive it by faith, why don't let's act like God has already done what we've asked him to do. Why don't you just go ahead and by faith praise him. By faith declare your healing. By faith declare your breakthrough and give him a crazy praise by faith. Come on, lift your voice and just give him a crazy praise by faith. Come on, we can do better than that. One more time, just a crazy praise by faith. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, shout, my God is good all the time and all the time. He is good. Put your hands together and give the Lord a praise in here this morning.
Jesus. Hallelujah. My goodness. My goodness, did you enjoy Brother Hans Hess? Amen. So I want our prayer partners to come quickly. our prayer partners. We're our prayer partners, please. So this has been in my spirit since before you got here this week. And I quoted it earlier in the conference, but if you give a cup of water in the name of a prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. And you all have given. You bless the men and women of God. Many of you have gone to great expense to be here, to travel. And all of it was sowing. And God wants you to receive the prophet's reward. We're going to do a prayer tunnel. We're going to do a fire tunnel. I mentioned to many people, our pastors, we've got, y'all want to do this? Yes. So how many of you believe in the impartation by laying on of hands? We have a lot of people in this room, and outside of God, it's a logistical nightmare, okay? But it's important. I believe it's in the heart of God for every person in this room to have hands laid on you. So I want all my guest ministry, if you will, to line up. Pastor Cheryl Elliott, you will be in charge of your prayer partners. Pastor Cheryl, I honor you. God bless you. You open service, and we love you. She's our prayer pastor and our women's pastor. We honor you. So I want all of our guest ministry, if you will, to line up across the stage, please. All of our guest ministry. And I think we ought to do two lines because of how many people there are. We'll do two lines. Now, this is what else I want you to do. Ladies, you can leave your purses. This is a very honest room today. Spirit-filled men and women of God, and nobody's going to steal your purse. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to get your offering out for Brother Hans Hess. We want to bless the man of God. We want to give in the name of a prophet. Did you receive from the man of God today? So go ahead and get your offering out. And so this just comes up in my spirit. But when you come by, you can just drop your offering on the stage, because you'll be lining up, or we'll get somebody with an offering bucket. I don't know. We just want to bless him. But I want you to be blessed. It is my hope and my desire that every person that came to this conference gets all that you need, that your cup runs over, that you go home filled up, that nobody goes back saying, I didn't get my miracle. We're going to do it. We're going to do it. God's going to do it, okay? All right, so and I'm going to ask you to, just because I want the people at the end of the line to get as much blessing as the people in the front of the line. Can we do that? All right, so I'm just going to ask you so respectfully just to keep walking, okay? Just keep walking. Doesn't have to be a big thing. You're just going to receive impartation. So I want our musicians, our praise team to go ahead, and I want our line to begin. So come quickly. Come quickly by section. Come quickly by section. Stay prayerful. Stay prayerful.
Oh, patiently just begin to intercede. Come on and see the atmosphere for the glory of God. Stretch out your hands towards those that are praying and those who are receiving prayer. Come on, we are believing for a manifestation of the Holy Ghost, a fresh touch and outpouring. Come on, this is fresh fire. Somebody intercede for fresh fire in Jesus' name. Just Thank you, Jesus. Come on, put your hands together.
Thank you. cleansing power revealing. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Now sing it. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Oh, He bought me and He's on me with His redeeming blood. Oh, it just keeps getting better. Just when you think it can't get any better, God just makes it better. Hallelujah. How many enjoyed the man of God today? My goodness. Pastor Hans proves that you can be smart and anointed. Hallelujah. Powerful word of the Lord. And I'm feeling something in my spirit for tomorrow. I believe that God is going to put the capstone on this conference tomorrow, and you don't want to miss it. There's just there's a rolling of revelation coming forth in my spirit, and we're going to declare some things prophetically over the church in this hour, and so it's going to be an amazing day. You got some instructions?
So if you're going to the building, what time is the tour to the building? 1:30 is, so you might have time to run through McDonald's or something like that, okay? But if you're driving, it is 709 Rivergate Parkway.
Next exit up from the freeway.
If you go I-65 north, it's the next exit up. And so you don't want to miss it. Rick and Debbie Massey are leading that. And I just want to pray over Brother Hans Hess. Brother Hans Hess, we want to pray over you and Dana. We just want to pray a blessing over your ministry. We just love you. We honor you. Would you stretch your hand toward the man and woman of God?
Amen.
They poured themselves out
praise
to us
God.
Today.
Lord, we just bless. Hallelujah. Dayababasotoria Sunday. No, God, we loose. Hallelujah. And open heaven over this man and woman of God, that Lord, for such a time as this, you've made them a team. And Lord, that quickly, Lord, you put this new building up. That, oh, son, don't be distracted by it. I'm going to take care of that. You take care of my kingdom and my house. So, Lord, we thank you in advance. God, that every dime, when they celebrate their opening night, it'll be debt-free in the name of the Lord. God, that debt cancellation has already been released out of the Spirit. Now, Lord, I thank you, hallelujah, that, God, the fires, there are new fires burning in thy belly, says the Lord. I'm not just sending you to places to preach a good message, but all signs, wonders, and miracles are going to confirm the word of the Lord. I'm going to challenge you. You're going to hear crazy things in your spirit. Do them, says the Lord. For that out of it comes the miraculous and the supernatural by the power of God. So, Lord, I speak, Lord, a unity, a oneness as never before. That, oh, God, you would loose on Dana, hallelujah, a fresh mantle. God, an area that she never walked in. A roar of the line of Judah begin to come up out of her spirit. Now, Lord, we loose on this house today in the name of the Lord. That the Spirit of God rest upon you. May the blessing of the Lord be your portion. May you walk out of here today and forever be the head and not the tail. May every debt be canceled in your life. May every demon spirit of harassment be broken in the name of the Lord. May God's hand be upon you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
You know what God's doing? He's just raising an army up. No sick soldiers.
Hallelujah, but full of the power of the Holy Ghost. And we're going to have a marvelous time. We got anything else?
I just want to tell them I love them. I love you
now,
so
from
much.
Somebody
I really
that really
do.
Means it, I love you.
What? I hope that you have enjoyed this conference, and I do hope. I hope that you can feel our arms around you, that we truly, truly want you to go away blessed and empowered and healed. I hope that you can sense that. We did not have a conference so we could just do something, you know, big in the city. I don't know what, why people have conferences. We truly want to empower you and be a blessing in your life. And I hope that you can feel that. And so if I haven't told, I forgot, did I even tell them I loved them?
Yeah, you did.
I did? Did I tell you? See? All right. I didn't. I love you.
I'm going to warn you, next year when we have this conference, you're going to have to get here early, because there are not going to be any seats open. In the next 12 months, you're going to see such an escalation of the power of God in this nation that it's going to be an amazing thing. So we'll see you tomorrow at 3 o'clock.
Did you enjoy Brother Samuel Rodriguez? Did you enjoy Brother Tony Suarez? Did you enjoy Dr. Hans Hess? Did you enjoy Pastor Jensen Franklin? Did you enjoy Higher Ground? Did you enjoy the praise team with Jasmine Brady? Yeah. Did you enjoy taking it to the streets with Burton Gar? Yeah, okay. Well, good. I'm glad you've had a good time. I'll see you tomorrow at 3 o'clock. All right. God bless you.